50 million years ago, in the North Coast ranges of California, a collision of the North American and Pacific plates lifted the Clearlake Basin above sea level. South of the active volcano now known as Mount Kinoctai, lava flows plugged the canyon creeks and flooded the flat valleys to form a lake that Eastern Pomo peoples called Xabaten, the largest natural lake in California. Rising out of the valley to a height of 4,200 feet, the volcano Kinoctai actually breathes. As the barometric pressure changes, large amounts of air move into and out of this sacred mountain. As many as 7,000 years before the Egyptian pyramids were built, humanity gathered in the Clearlake Basin. For almost 12,000 years, the ancestors of the present-day indigenous lake peoples lived happy, prosperous, and peaceful lives. Life was a sacred experience. Everything had a spirit. Responsibility for the land was based on respect for all life. Despite the current myth that they lived primarily as hunter-gatherers, the actual fact is that they carefully managed their environment. Plants were closely observed to see which species and varieties flourished in drought and flood conditions. Those plants were then carefully nurtured and seeds were gathered and replanted to intentionally increase those resources during periods of weather extremes. Areas of the surrounding mountains and forests were burned every 4 years to increase the habitat for game animals, improve the quality of the soil, and reduce the danger of wildfires. Tule beds around the lake were also burned to increase and strengthen their habitat. With abundant fresh water and a climate similar to the European Mediterranean, food and the resources for living were plentiful and easy to come by. The lake peoples enjoyed many varieties of fish in the lake and surrounding streams. Different villages would come together to line the creeks during the spring spawning, and here they would dry hundreds of pounds of fish for use throughout the year. Though the lake was clean enough to drink, the peoples dug shallow wells and even transplanted suckerfish into the canyon stream ponds to keep the confined water clear and fresh to drink. As many as 9 different species of oak provided for a specialized choice in the other primary staple of the people, acorns. These acorns were boiled into gruel and mush, as well as being baked underground into the bread, haro. In addition to fish and acorns, pinon, pepperwood nuts, and buckeyes joined seasonal fresh foods such as clams, green clover, waterfowl, bird eggs, and special insects. There were also tules and other roots, and a number of different kinds of berries to complete their perfect diet. A diet so nourishing that living past 100 years of age became a usual occurrence even into the middle 1900s. The rich resources of the Clearlake Basin created a unique culture. Peaceful in nature, with plenty of free time for cultural and spiritual development, they developed complicated crafts, particularly basketry. Thank you. 10,000 years of experience with the changes of nature and their environment did not prepare the indigenous peoples around Khaba 10 for the destructive coming of the light-skinned men they called Masan. Masan means an unreal people, able to kill without compunction and for no apparent reason. In only a few decades, an ancient civilization faced genocide. Though studied and documented by historians, anthropologists, and archaeologists, their survivors are only now beginning to tell their own story. In 2002, the people from the present village of Jalanapo, also known as the Big Valley Band of Pomo Indians, received a 3-year language preservation grant award from the Administration for Native Americans. We think it is important for our viewers to understand why such an old and viable language, one that has been spoken for literally thousands of years, should need to be preserved from extinction. To do that, we must revisit the time of first contact with the Masan. Lake County peoples probably first became aware of light-skinned invaders hearing about Spanish missionaries and military. But one of their first real contacts undoubtedly came about through their interaction with the coastal Pomo. Lake tribes made regular trips to the coast to trade, fish, gather seaweed, clams, clamshell, and other coastal treasures. The clamshell and abalone shell were cut, shaped, and drilled into whil, Indian money, or made into jewelry for baskets, ceremonial regalia, or personal adornment.
We kept the exact dates of coastal low tides and timed our trips accordingly. The 80-mile trip was accomplished in just 2 days with only one stop. Every adult carried a large basket and minimal supplies. After making our harvest, we rested a couple of days to visit with our friends, cure fish, and prepare our return to the lake. Each of our carrying baskets weighed up to 130 pounds. The trip back home took up to 5 full days.
In 1812, the Russians and their foreign natives established Fort Ross at what is now called Bodega Bay. They came for the valuable sea otter furs, coveted by the upper classes of America, Europe, and Russia. Though many contemporary accounts say it was a peaceful treaty that allowed Fort Ross to flourish, privately, natives remember a different history. To increase the comfort of the invading force, these foreigners began kidnapping younger women for sexual slaves and domestics, demanding that the older women and children labor in the fields. By holding the families hostage, the Pomo men were coerced into providing most of the food for the fort and helped to bring in the valuable furs. If the men resisted, the women and children were tortured and killed. The publicly accepted story is that the Russians sold their interests voluntarily in 1841. But this discounted the fact that the local Pomo finally mounted a fierce resistance that influenced the Russian flight. Unfortunately, this occurred 4 years after the most insistent European killer, smallpox, had issued from Fort Ross to devastate not only the coastal Pomo, but the Wapo, Wintun, and Coast Miwok nations as well.
Though we had some contact with smallpox in those days, we avoided this wave of tribe-killing pandemics, probably because of our geographical isolation. But now we begin to suffer from unknown respiratory infections. We lost many of our babies, our young children, our elders.
By 1840, diseases reached epidemic proportions through the entire state of California. North of San Francisco, at least 60,000 native lives were lost.
Space in your heart.
The Spanish missionary system reached into the Sonoma area by 1823. The missions had gained an unfavorable notoriety when at one mission the Holy Fathers, anticipating a visit from traveling bishops, used their indoctrinated Indians to advertise a large baptismal ceremony to be performed for natives of the area. The natives who answered the call were baptized and then promptly killed. They offered no resistance, but word of their fate made other natives wary of all the missions. The military cohorts of the missionary fathers were led by General Mariano Vallejo. Mariano and his brother Salvador acquired holdings in the Napa-Sonoma Valley and set about conscripting all the local indigenous people as laborers. During the late 1830s, at the same time that Pomo hearts were on the ground in grief for their children and elders lost to disease, General Vallejo was organizing an expedition to explore the Clearlake Basin. His brother Salvador and Ramon Carrillo, accompanied by a contingent of soldiers, embarked on a series of exploratory raids into Lake County. Many Pomo were killed outright, with large numbers of young men, women, and children captured, kidnapped, and sold into slavery in nearby counties. Almost immediately after these depredations, the two Vallejo brothers petitioned for 640 leagues of land in the Clearlake Basin and began herding a great number of cattle into the valleys around Clearlake. The grazing of these animals began what was to ultimately become an almost complete transformation of the rich and abundant lands and habitat of Lake County.
A number of our strong men from the Big Valley village of Habenapo were conscripted by Vallejo to ride herd on their stock in the valley. They even forced us to move from our main villages to make room for the grazing cattle.
By 1841, the Vallejos had established a ranch in Napa Valley with large ripening crops of standing wheat and barley. Since there were not enough Indian laborers in the valley to harvest the crops, the Vallejos sent messengers to demand that Lake County natives come to their aid. When local natives refused to volunteer to help with the harvest, and in reprisal for the stealing of a cow, more than 60 Mexican troops accompanied Salvador Vallejo into Lake County to compel them to comply. When the soldiers were informed by the leaders that under no circumstances would the people be going to Sonoma, they responded by bayoneting the leader, setting fire to the roundhouse, and burning and shooting the remaining native peoples. Over 300 of the Alem people perished. The local native peoples were so enraged by this depravity that Vallejo never returned, despite receiving final approval of their application for the land grant of Laguna de Lupiomi around 1844. Their cattle ran wild in Lake County for 6 years before their holdings were sold to Benjamin and Andrew Kelsey, Edward Sherland, and Charles Stone in 1847. The Kelseys came to the area with an intense hatred of all native people. Ben Kelsey's 13-year-old daughter had been previously scalped and lived only a few more years after her ordeal. They commonly referred to all native peoples as varmints and considered them less than human. California whites had begun talking of an independent California in 1846, and the three Kelsey brothers, though friends with the Vallejo brothers, were active in the Bear Flag Revolt to free California from Mexican rule. In 1848, the U.S. and Mexico signed the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. Native indigenous Californians and their land rights were supposed to have been protected under the articles of this treaty, but immigrating Californians had something else in mind. 77 years of Mexican rule had resulted in almost a 50% loss of population among the native nations of California. But what was to come was even more devastating. In 1848, rich copper beds were discovered near Clearlake. But that discovery was almost lost with the announcement that James Marshall, a New Jersey carpenter, had discovered gold while constructing a mill for John Sutter on the American River. Sutter and John Marshall attempted to keep the find secret for 5 months, but Sam Brannan, a Mormon store owner near Sutter's Fort, came up with a plan to draw potential customers to his store. He walked through the streets of Yerba Buena, San Francisco, shouting, "Gold! Gold from the American River!" This sounded the death knell for native peoples and their culture in California. In a little over 2 years after the discovery, more than 100,000 native people lost their lives. ...80,000 new citizens. Numerous paramilitary groups sprang up in Northern California. Between 1849 and 1860, groups like the Humboldt Home Guard, the Eel River Minutemen, and the Placer Blades prowled the countryside attacking Indians and stealing children. A native woman named Betsy from the gold area was quoted as saying, "A life of ease and peace was interrupted when I was a girl by the arrival of the white men. Each day their population increased and the Indians feared the invaders. As gold excitement advanced, we moved again and again, each time in haste. Children, when taken into town, would have their faces blackened with dirt so the newcomers wouldn't steal them." Respected 19th century historian Hubert Bancroft wrote, "The California Valley cannot grace her annals with a single Indian war bordering on respectability. It can, however, boast of 100 or 2 of the other on the part of our honest miners and brave pioneers." Andrew Kelsey, age 27, and Charles Stone were the Lake Como's first intimate introduction to American frontier adventurers. The Kelseys arrived in California in 1841 with the Bidwell Bartleson immigrant party. Ben Kelsey's wife, Nancy, was the first white woman to come with an immigrant party to California. Nancy was said to have offered part of her petticoat and her sewing skills to create the flag for the new California Republic. The Kelseys settled in the Napa-Sonoma Valley and had become familiar with the story of the rich grazing land around Clearlake. They were attracted to the fact that the Vallejo's abandoned cattle still roam free and saw a quick opportunity for riches. Vallejo undoubtedly painted a rosy picture of their numerous abandoned herds to close the sale, but it was the quick and easy workforce available from the indigenous inhabitants that attracted the Kelseys' attention.
Kelsey and Stone forced one of our leaders, Shook, and three other vaqueros from Big Valley to round up and ride herd on the abandoned Vallejo stock. They forced us to build a large adobe house for them near Hitchbidummy, a creek we named after a particularly succulent species of fish that spawned in huge numbers in the spring. After the construction, they paid us with a few bandanas and meager rations. There was a lot of hard feelings about that.
Stone and Kelsey had, in addition to their holdings in the Clearlake region, one or more mines in the Sierra country. They used to round up groups of Indians and take them over to their mines as workers. Here they were forced to do the hardest kind of work and were kept on very meager rations. Informants freely used the term starve to describe the plight of these workers. Any offense of a worker was punished by whipping, a trivial offense drawing sometimes as many as 50 lashes. In 1848, almost 300 of the younger men were marched over to the mines. They were worked very hard, were underfed, and were treated cruelly. In 1849, only 150 workers were marched to the mines. These were treated even more cruelly than those of the preceding year. As soon as they reached their destination, Ben Kelsey discovered that it was more profitable to sell the supplies to Oregonian gold seekers than to join them. These sales included all the food for the expedition. Soon after the sale, Kelsey and many of the native Pomo who accompanied him fell ill with malaria and dysentery. Kelsey had to be carried home, abandoning the others.
Only a handful of men who accompanied Kelsey there returned. Later we found out that most had died of starvation, exposure, or disease. The Kelseys lied to us and told us not to worry. They would come home eventually, but a few of the survivors brought home the truth. It was a betrayal we could not forget.
The Kelsey brothers had used earnings from their previous gold field outings to purchase over 1,000 additional cattle to run on their Lake County holdings. It took 6 trips for Shook and other vaqueros to drive the herd north into Big Valley. Kelsey and Stone also used their new adobe along Kelsey Creek as a country club to host many of their outlaw and vagabond friends from the Gold Rush area of Sacramento. These men would visit and enjoy the various entertainments Kelsey and Stone would provide at the natives' expense.
They would shoot at us for sport. Some of the people were killed. Already we were starving. These men were like animals. They had no regrets about raping and molesting our adolescent and teenage girls. Even preteen girls were not immune from their ugliness. Sometimes 2 or 3 times a week, they demanded that we bring our daughters to their house for their enjoyment. If we disobeyed, our hands were tied and a rope was thrown over a tree limb. We were drawn up, sometimes with only our toes touching or dangling in the air. Then they whipped us unmercifully. We resisted, so the punishments occurred almost as often as their demands.
In 1848, the starving people of Big Valley surrounded Kelsey and Stone and demanded that they return all the hunting implements they had confiscated. Word managed to reach Ben Kelsey, who along with a ragtag collection of volunteers arrived in time to bring enough firepower to avert violence. The Big Valley people were then forced to accompany the whites into Scotts Valley, where they were forced to participate in the torture of a Scotts Valley native to discover the hiding place of the villagers there. The villagers were captured, the Scotts Valley Rancheria burned, and all the Indians from Big Valley and Scotts Valley were marched back into Big Valley. From there, Kelsey and his vigilantes marched a mixed group of Indians to their Sonoma ranch to help their friends, the Vallejos, build a new hacienda. Shook, also known as Augustine, was one of the Big Valley leaders who was forced to go with them. He eventually escaped to return to his home.
When Shook came home, he found out that Kelsey and Stone had taken his wife into their household to serve them. Once Kelsey found out that Shook was back from Sonoma, he got really angry and locked him up for almost a week with no rations. Eventually, most of the people taken to Sonoma came home. But after they let Shook out, Kelsey and Stone seemed to become afraid. They built a high stockade fence around the outside of each of our two villages to keep us in. We weren't allowed to go outside to hunt or fish. Some of our riders rode the fence at night looking for people trying to escape. Everyone was afraid they would be killed for no reason. People found outside were tied up and confined to a room at the adobe until the next day when they were whipped. During the winter, 20 older people perished from starvation. Four more died from their injuries from whippings. One young man was shot to death by Stone for visiting his aunt, who lived at Stone's house, for borrowing 5 cups of wheat for his sick mother. Finally, it was too much. We agreed that our starvation had to end.
According to William Benson, two of the head writers, Shook and Chassis, were delegated the task of killing a beef for the starving villagers. Bad weather, bad luck caused their plan to fail. Stone's horse threw its rider and ran off. They knew that when it was found, the white men would react with fatal consequences. The time to end their suffering had come. The next day, both Stone and Kelsey faced the execution they deserved. Many accounts of the events that followed have been written, but at least one native account tells us that Shook's wife poured water into the gunpowder the night before, and the following morning, both Stone and Kelsey were killed. The people gathered all the necessities they could carry and left for other areas of the county to hide themselves from the reprisals they knew would come. Undoubtedly, they rejoiced as they fed on the cattle that had been fattening freely while the people had starved in captivity. In the meantime, in the Napa Valley, Ben Kelsey learned of his brother's execution and hurriedly put together a gang of vigilantes. They didn't even make it out of the county before they murdered a number of friendly native people in the Napa area. Local citizens turned them in immediately and they were arrested, but they were never prosecuted. Kelsey approached the U.S. Army's Lieutenant J.W. Davidson, and a military party was organized to chastise the Indians. With Kit Carson's brother Moses leading the way, they reached the site of the execution and buried Stone's remains. No mention was made of Kelsey in Davidson's report. The following day, Davidson approached the island of Badon Napoti, a major fishing village for the northwestern lake peoples. But he was unable to cross the lake in full winter. He returned to Sonoma and submitted a new plan of attack to Brevet Major Persifer Smith. The major gave the mission to Brevet Captain Nathaniel Lyon, who marched immediately for Clearlake. He reached Robinson's Point to rendezvous with locals on May 11th. Firing a round from a mountain howitzer, Lyon attacked from three sides on the morning of May 15th, 1850. Though contemporary accounts claim that Indians had gathered on the island to avoid the depredations of the military, native peoples believed that the inhabitants of Badon-Napoti were participating in one of the two large yearly fish harvests. During the spring, after the creek fish spawning runs had exhausted themselves, lake fish gathered in the tules to spawn on the south side of the island. At least one settler account supports the native oral history that the natives were unaware of the soldiers' mission or intentions and attempted to welcome them in peace. According to native accounts, a significant number of the men were away hunting, leaving mostly old people, women, and children on the island. Island Indians realized the truth from the first and only firing of the howitzer. When it became evident that the soldiers had boats and could easily reach their island village, they fled to the northern and eastern sides, where shallow waters allowed for escape to the mainland. Unfortunately, the soldiers were prepared for this escape attempt and rose up in waist-deep waters to savagely and indiscriminately kill more than 150 elders, women, and children. Lion marched off to the Russian River to kill more natives he believed responsible in the Kelsey Stone execution, while the local people spent the next 5 days gathering up their dead and cremating him in a large funeral pyre on Badon-Bidami, Island Creek. Most of the survivors fled into the mountains to the northeast to escape the marauding vigilantes looking for native children to take to the central California slave markets. Mildred Duncan left us a poignant reminder of the effects of Lake County's second native Holocaust.
There was two men that used to enslave the Indians. Stone and Kelsey was their name. My name is Mildred Duncan. I'm affiliated with the Robinson Rancheria. Pomo Indian. My grandmother was one of the survivors of Bloody Arvin. She was 6 years old when this happened. The soldiers and the vigilantes came over to kill the Pomos. Kill all the Pomos, any Pomo they'd seen. So they went to this island and the leader said, Welcome, my good man, he said. Don't harm my people, and they shot him. Then they start killing women and children, old people. Babies, they would stick their bayonets in and throw them in the water. Then one little baby was crawling along, and the soldier stepped on her back. He thought he killed her because he left. And all her life, she walked with a stoop. I remember her. She was stooped over walking even when she was young. And my grandmother used to tell me about Bloody Island. They'd have a fire going, and my grandfather would be singing Indian song. My grandmother would be telling the story, and she'd be crying. I get emotional when I think about this, what they did to my people. She was hiding in the tules. She was breathing through a straw. When she seen it was getting dark under the water, she said she came up. The blood was all over and the water was red. She said her and her mother came up out of the water. Everybody was gone. Themselves, we wouldn't even been here. So I thank Hadika, Bakuriba, Hadika. Thank you.
As these retaliatory punishments were being effected against the peoples of the lake, California became the 31st state in the Union. The first state legislature denied the Indian right to vote and passed the Act for the Government and Protection of Indians 1 month before the massacre at Bloody Island, effectively legalizing Indian slavery in California. It was obvious that the native survivors were not of the slightest concern to the majority of white Californians when it came to their most human needs. In 1851, the federal government, through the U.S. Senate, authorized treaty-making expeditions to secure legal title of the lands of California in exchange for establishing reserves for native tribes where they could live undisturbed by whites with federal assistance. Reddick McKee was appointed to negotiate the treaties with Northern California tribes. McKee came up the Russian River, over the mountain ridges north of Hopland, California, to the ancient Indian Trail that enters Lake County on the ridge over the junction of Benmore Creek and South Scotts Creek. On August 18th, he made his way into Lake County with the Treaty of Peace and Friendship. Traveling through what is now Lakeport, he advanced to Big Valley and proceeded to camp. Calls went out to various tribes, and McKee successfully negotiated a treaty, promising the Lake tribes the entire Clearlake Basin, as well as a significant amount of material goods, and the promise that no settlers would be allowed on Indian lands. McKee negotiated many more treaties with tribes in Northern California, and by the time he was finished, Californians were hysterical at the promises made in the 18 treaties that were signed. Governor Bigler hurriedly penned McKee a letter that stated,
"The treaties negotiated by you are opposed to the best wishes and interests of the state."
Whites were infuriated that the Indians should be given so many of the richest and most productive mineral lands and resources. They immediately petitioned their Washington representatives to force Congress to deny ratification. On June 1st, President Millard Fillmore submitted the 18 treaties to the Senate. They were printed in confidence and rejected in executive session on July 8th, with the added provision that the entire issue be placed under an order of secrecy. That secrecy lasted more than 50 years. Senator Weller excused the action by saying,
"It would be utterly impossible to secure to the Indians the undisturbed possession of the reservations."
J.J. Turner, of the Special Committee to Inquire into Indian Treaties in California, spoke for the Indians.
"As the love of gold blotted from our minds all feelings of compassion and justice?"
The silence that followed spoke an unqualified yes. President Fillmore commented,
"The Indians will now be mere tenants at sufferance and liable to be driven from place to place at the pleasure of the whites."
The reality turned out to be much, much worse. Despite this refusal of ratification, both the state and federal government acted as if title to Indian lands had been legally secured. Congress formed a commission to validate land claims and issued instructions for local newspapers and agents to inform Native peoples that anyone who considered they still held title to the land must register their claims. Of course, no one told the Native people, and none of their claims were registered. In the meantime, the peoples continued to believe they had achieved a lasting peace and saved their homelands for their generations to come. To the settlers, Indian people were seen to be as undesirable and obstructive as the grizzly bears they were extinguishing at almost the same rate. Within 2 years, more and more settlers began homesteading in Lake County, and Lake Natives became more and more confused.
"We thought we had a treaty. The whites were supposed to stay out of our country, and for a couple of years they did. But we never did get the promised rations and supplies, except for a few beef cattle, and pretty soon here come the settlers. Anything the government sent for us was appropriated by the local Indian agent. The agent gave all the treaty items to local settlers instead of us. For the next few years, we still harvested, hunted, and gathered our foods the way we always had. But every season that passed, we saw more and more of our giant acorn oaks and our beautiful meadows cleared for agriculture and grazing. They forced us to move again and again from our regular village and campsites. When we questioned what right they had to these lands, they would tell us that they were just leasing it and soon we would be paid. Meanwhile, the government was helping them build their homes and even gave them financial aid to develop their farms and ranches. All they needed to qualify was to run a few head of goats or cattle, or to drop in a few black walnut seeds. Gradually, most of our village sites and our best hunting and gathering grounds became the homesteads of settlers. The richest lands were taken quickly. Suddenly, we began hearing the words private property. We heard those words even in our dreams. We could no longer go to this place for army worms, or to that place for tobacco, or those places for acorns. When we killed a deer, they wanted to arrest us.
All over California, the white citizenry began demanding that a solution to the Indian problem be found. In 1853, the federal government proposed establishing four major reservations for California natives. They were to be the Smith River Valley Res, the Hoopa Valley Res, the Round Valley Res, and the Tule River Res. Many other allotments were proposed, but as the Secretary of the Interior, Harold Ickes, commented,
"3/4 of all allotments for Indians are absolutely unfit for human habitation."
Few of the monies and supplies made it past the Indian agents and their cronies. It took a full month to communicate with Washington, and the federal government never cared or understood the problems of California natives. While the average California citizen believed that their very survival depended upon the total removal or extermination of the Indians. Local citizens, particularly in Northern California, proposed a solution. The Yreka Herald editorialized,
"We hope that the government will render such aid as will enable the citizens of the North to carry on a war of extermination until the last redskin of these tribes has been killed. Extermination is no longer a question of time. The time has arrived. The work has commenced. And let the first man who says treaty or peace be regarded as a traitor."
California Governor Peter Burnett made a highly publicized statement that unless all the Indians were sent east to the Sierras,
a war of extinction would continue to be waged until the Indian race should become extinct.
White communities in California began instituting subscription programs to pay for vigilante groups to collect Indian scalps. Eventually, the state of California joined the effort, and over $1 million was paid out for these souvenirs. Through 1859, vigilante groups increased, with such groups as the Salmon Guard, the Union Volunteers, the Pitt River Rangers, and the Klamath Rifles. Klamath County had at least 8 such companies. In 1856 alone, they were issued over 1,500 muskets and 1,000 rifles. The state of California paid their wages at up to $15 per day. By 1854, local ranchers began pressing local natives into service on their ranches and agricultural properties. Also in 1854, many of the vigilante groups, at large mercenaries and slave traders, began to accelerate their quest for native children. The Alta California reported,
"Abducting children has become quite a common practice. Nearly all of the children belonging to some of the Indian tribes in the northern part of the state have been stolen. They are taken to the southern part of the state and sold."
W.C. Goldsmith, a Lower Lake settler in 1858, stated,
"In those early days, slavery was a common practice among the whites. There were those who made a business of it. They would watch for a poorly protected rancheria or fishing camp. They would surround it and kill off all the adults, Then they would take the children and sell them.
The Sacramento Union reported,
"There is a class of whites who systematically kill adults to get their children."
A U.S. agent filed this report.
"A band of desperate men have carried out a system of kidnapping. Indian children are seized and sold into slavery. The kidnappers follow at the heels of the soldiers to seize the children when the parents are murdered."
One can imagine the trauma that 20 years of child stealing had caused among Native parents. But another depravity began sweeping California, one that local Natives were intimately familiar with. It was best summed up by a Sacramento newspaper.
"We are assured there has been no recent hostile disposition manifested by the Indians toward whites. The only depravities have been provoked by a group of characters who stay nearby the villages and are in constant habit of committing the grossest outrages upon the Indian women."
A San Francisco paper went even further.
"Some of the agents and nearly all the employees around the reservations are daily and nightly engaged in kidnapping the younger portion of the females for the vilest of purposes. The wives and daughters are offended before the very eyes of their husbands and fathers who are these civilized monsters, and they dare not resent the insult or even complain of the hideous outrage."
The result of this intimate carnage immediately presented another threat to the Native peoples of California: syphilis. The New York Century reported in May 1860 that a doctor
who has spent much time there informs us that intercourse by the whites with Clearlake Indians has laid the foundation for their extermination by disease. Of the women examined from the age of 10 years and upward, not a single individual was found to be free of the disease.
In the period from 1850 to 1860, the non-native population of Lake County increased from 0 to 972 whites on 270 homesteads. During the early 1860s, the next outbreak of disease struck the peoples. Smallpox returned with its friends, whooping cough, measles, and colds. With no immunity and little access to conventional medicines, the indigenous people suffered the worst.
"Once again, our children and elders began dying. Our diet had changed. We were weaker and not as strong as before. The settlers couldn't stand to see this uncleared land. They said that it was a waste and chopped down the trees like they hated them. The many seasons of cattle grazing changed where plants would grow and many disappeared. We began to see animals we had never seen before, and many of those old kinds retreated to the high mountains. Only a few of our traditional food gathering sites survived. Food became more and more difficult to gather for the lean winter months. We had to go to work for the ranchers and they paid us very little. We were like dirt to them. But it was the loss of our children and elders that hurt us so bad. In only a few seasons, we lost at the same time the knowledge of our past and our hope for the future."
In the late 1860s, Big Valley native William Benson reported being only one of three children to survive a whooping cough epidemic in the Big Valley village of Habanapo. From 1850 to 1871, the infant mortality rate for Native children was over 50%. Across the entire state, less than 30,000 indigenous people remained. Been with In 1869, E.S. Parker, Commissioner of Indian Affairs, put to rest Indian claims that the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo had supported their land claims and rights by writing,
"The U.S. acquired possession of the territory of Mexico, and as Mexico considered itself the absolute unqualified owner of it, the United States was under no obligation to treat with the Indians for extinguishment of their title."
It was as if a neighbor had moved into your neighborhood and without your knowledge claimed your property, then sold it to another without even telling you. Next thing you know, the buyer comes along and demands your house. His family and strength surpass yours, so you have no choice but to give in. That's what happened to the native peoples of Lake County. By 1870, the non-native population of Lake County had reached 2,870 whites, 100 Chinese, on 623 homesteads. The effect of the miners was to muddy the streams and frighten away the fish and game. They soon needed gardens, and the best seed and tuber fields were plowed under for these purposes. The homesteaders' stock needed fencing, and their hogs loved the acorns from the giant oak trees that had provided the other native staple. Gathering areas were sectioned off for grazing. Agriculture required the clearing and development of the land into private ownership. The local indigenous population, devastated by disease and the loss of their most valuable village sites and harvest areas, were overcome by a crisis in confidence of their most basic cultural and spiritual institutions.
Before the coming of the Masson, most of our rituals for childbirth and child raising were performed to ensure their health and well-being. Despite our sacrifices, the diseases of the Masson killed the children without warning. Our ritual and ceremonial beliefs seemed to lose their power, and the loss of many of our important elder leaders began to affect the passing of our oral tradition and the knowledge of how to perform our old ceremonies correctly.
In 1867, the Franciscan father, Luciano Osuna, began to teach Christianity to the indigenous people of Clearlake. But he was to face one last obstacle in his mission to bring native peoples into his flock. The native people around the lake were ready for a new Indian hope, a new native tradition. The 1870 ghost dance spread out like waves from western Nevada, where the northern Paiute prophet Wovoka promised that dancing a certain way, with specific visions for guidance, would bring back the old world and renew the life of native peoples across the nation. Not only did his message travel east to the plains tribes and beyond, it made its way west to the Patwin of Long Valley, who carried it to the eastern and southeastern Pomo peoples around Clearlake. They took what they wanted from the promise and from the tradition to embrace the Maru, a sacred story. The ceremony was dreamed, and for the first time women were permitted to take the ceremonial role of leadership. A new spirit of cooperation seemed to accompany the Maru, with a new hope that the hostile white populations might be swept away and the old peace and prosperity return.
We built a new marak in Big Valley in the early 1870s after learning about the Maru. Native people from all over Pomo country came here to participate in the renewal of our world. As many as 4,000 natives danced and dreamed with us for almost 2 years. Then gradually, as the seasons passed and passed again, we realized that that sacred dream was not to be. It was very hard for many of the people to return home. They had left everything behind. It was hard for us too. So many people here for so long had just about exhausted all the game and resources. Now we had to go to work for the whites. Their attitude toward us was very bad. In 1875, they petitioned to have all of us removed to Round Valley. They approved the order in 1880. If it wasn't for the mission and one local rancher in Big Valley who refused to let them come in on his land and take us, we would all be gone from here.
Some of the Big Valley people became Christians. In 1875, 160 acres were purchased for the mission of St. Turibus, and natives were provided the security of being able to live in one location continually in exchange for baptism and a renunciation of all traditional ceremonial life. Within 5 years, over 100 people resided there. Those that did not faced a continual struggle to find locations to camp and the resources to live. The old world was changing its face. To many, it was no longer recognizable. Some of the families maintained the older traditions, some adhered to newer ones, and by the turn of the century, some turned to the bottle for comfort. The oral tradition had been severely damaged by the loss of so many elders and children over two generations. The land was no longer capable of sustaining the people, and indeed had changed so drastically it was hardly Lake County older people remembered. There were new plants, new animals, and the careless destruction of natural resources caused many of the people to lose their contact with the land, other than their daily work as agricultural laborers, the only kind of work the men could find. The old bond between the land and the people, the recognition of the spirits of water, rock, and other forms of life, were diminished by the pain, degradation, and need to survive in a foreign world. A number of traditional families still held on to these principles, but out of what once were hundreds of thousands, even millions, by 1900, only 16,000 indigenous Californians had survived the coming of the Masan. It's easy to sum up the nightmare. Some reject the use of the word Holocaust, preferring to use it in a more modern context, but the destruction of humanity and the acts of men were identical to those of the monsters of today. Our next statement paraphrases a comment by John Collier, the Commissioner of Indian Affairs. They were treated as animals to be shot on sight. They were enslaved, starved, and worked to death. They were molested and infected. Their life was outlawed, and their whole existence was condemned. Their hearts were broken, and they died.
Sometimes the wind comes out of nowhere and knocks you off your feet. And look, see my tears. They fill the whole night sky. The whole night sky.
Many Americans of today question the need for this history to be told. They say, that was the past. Let us forget the past and go forward together. It wasn't my responsibility. I didn't do this. But there are other reasons for remembering this history. History is often repeated. As William B. Seacrest wrote, Californians of the mid-1800s were conditioned to their attitudes the same way modern Americans are. They were accustomed to their elected leaders talking about the inevitable need to exterminate the Indians. Respected officials of all kinds referred to them as the degraded and filthy Redskins, as if that were their natural state rather than the one civilization had brought them to. And finally, the press completed the assault of indoctrination by continually using derogatory terms and racist remarks when writing about them in their articles and editorials. This onslaught from the leading citizens of the state gave an aura of respectability and justification to the groups of citizens indulging themselves in participating in the most horrific criminal behaviors mankind can exhibit. None can underestimate the effect of the word exterminate upon a populace generally lacking in morals. The word was repeated endlessly and made its indelible mark on the psyche of Californians. Its premise had been eagerly accepted by non-Indian immigrants to the North American continent from the beginning. Charles Darwin and others encouraged and foisted the idea that it was simply predestined that the Indian peoples of these lands should be doomed to extinction. The ideal was accepted by some as a tragic and hopeless inevitability, and by all as a genuine and divine natural law. The cold, hard fact remains that the Indians were ruthlessly destroyed in California, and that this was accomplished not only directly by the most brutal class of settler, but with the acquiescence of all the decent people who did not care enough to be outraged about what was taking place. This is a valuable lesson that we can take to heart today, that decent people should always have the courage to stand up and speak out when they see wrongs being done. And if they don't, they share in the responsibility for the tragedy. In the 21st century, the Eastern Pomo Big Valley and the surrounding lake communities have high hopes for their children, that poverty and racism will disappear, and that a resurgence in their people's participation in the old forms of cultural and spiritual expression will carry them safely through any further adversity. The continued preservation and revitalization of the Eastern Pomo language will play an important part in that effort. It may be that in the near future, the indigenous people of Lake County may be looked to for their natural leadership on issues of cultural and environmental resource preservation. The knowledge of 500 generations of life on these lands cannot be easily extinguished or discounted. It is preserved in their language and in their blood. They still walk the mountains, ridges, and valleys of their homeland. Their children still swim in the lake. They are the real people. And the experiences recounted here have resulted in a wisdom that will serve them well. California Indians did not vanish from these lands. They are like the rocks, like the water, like the trees, like the fish, like the acorn. They will survive.
I think about how I'm doing, but I don't know what I'm thinking. Shattering into shadow light, reflecting thoughts I can't relieve. My heart doesn't hurt anymore, but my soul does. Maybe that's what souls are for, to take the hurt the heart can't take, the heart can't take. Some things are private between me and the dead, and some of the rest is better off left unsaid. My heart doesn't hurt anymore. But my soul does. Maybe that's what souls are for. To take the hurt the heart can't take. The heart can't take.
My heart doesn't hurt anymore. But my soul